Looks like no business was no business for my occupation was done this morning. Everybody looks like they got here in one piece. Good. When you get a chance, please sign the pew pads. And I just got back. Hope and I went down to Hilton Head to spend some time with our family. So if you can give a little pity to Hope because she got to spend that many days with my family, it might go a little ways for me. I'd appreciate it. Friendly reminder, put 2016 on your checks. I get there about April myself. We have a bunch of poinsettias. Free to a good home. Please take one. Please take another one if you can give it to someone. They're going to be disposed of. Please help yourself. The young adults will start meeting again Tuesday at 7 p.m. at the Simpsons home. The class meetings are starting again. We're going to undecorate for Christmas on this coming Saturday, the 9th, at 10:30 a.m., meet here in the sanctuary. The next contemporary service is on the 17th at 7 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. And if you haven't been down there, they've really got a really neat setup going down there. That's really commendable how they've got things all arranged and everything. Game night will be this Friday, 6:30 in the library. And it is a very special day for a very special person today. And I want to leave you with just that little tidbit and pay attention to the joys today. You'll hear it then. I'd like to join in the opening hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem, hymn 230. Please rise.
Thank you.
worship. Everlasting God, the radiance of faithful souls, who brought the nations to your light and kings to the brightness of your rising, fill the world with your glory and show yourself to all the nations through him who is the true light and the bright and morning star, even Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Please enjoy the anthem from the choir. Children, please come down for a message from Jeff.
Hey, good morning, guys. There you go. There you go. That happens. Great to see y'all. Happy New Year. I brought something with me. How many of you guys got a Christmas present for Christmas? At least one. You got something? Well, I did too, and I brought it to show you. This is something that my mom made for me. It's a little pillow, and it actually has a picture of our Grand Canyon vacation, of me standing on a rock with my arms up. And it's kind of a neat gift, but we all have gifts that might have been a cool thing for us to get. Maybe we got a toy for Christmas, or maybe we got clothes, or how many of you folks got socks? Did anybody get socks for Christmas? Yeah, there you go. Socks are always a good thing to get. Yeah. But you know what? You know what happens, though, with socks? Sometimes they get holes in them, and sometimes our feet get too big for the socks that we have right now. So they don't necessarily last. If you got any clothes for Christmas, you might wear them out. They might get too big. You know what's going to happen someday? Yeah, you're going to have to give them to your sister or your brother or something like that. You're right. But you know what could happen with this? You know, if I have this sitting out, you know, and the sun comes through, it could fade this pillow eventually. You know, or you know what? I have a cat that lives with me, and he could chew a little hole in this pillow possibly. So, you know what? Sometimes the gifts that we get for Christmas don't last because we grow, and they're good for the time of right now. We might get a toy that might break or something, but let me tell you something. We got a gift for Christmas that will last with us forever. And do you know what that gift is? No. What comes at Christmas time, and it's the gift that will be with us the rest of our life, that will never wear out. And that is baby Jesus. Jesus came on Christmas. That's why we celebrate Christmas. And it is the gift that will never wear out, will never get too big for this gift. It will never break. Jesus will be with us for the rest of our life. And it is a gift that we need to cherish and know that it will be there for us. It is everlasting. So let's pray this morning as we think about this gift. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for this gift of Jesus, that it will be with us forever and will never fade, will never go away, will never break, we will never get too big for. It will not fade. Lord, we thank you for this gift of Jesus Christ. And we pray as we go our different ways today, that we would take this gift with us and share it to the world. And we pray this in your most blessed name. Amen. I do have the gift of chocolate to give you this morning, and I know that that will not last either. So you can take this with you as you go your separate ways, and you're dismissed to go to Children's Church. There you go. One of the things that the new year brings with it is a change of leadership. Some people will be starting up some new roles in the church. Some people will be continuing new roles. If you look in your bulletin, there is a list of leadership here in the church. And if you notice on this list of leadership, there are some blank spaces. We're still looking to fill some of those spaces, especially with the PPRC, SPRC, which is Staff Parish Relations, and the Board of Trustees. So if you are a member and you would like to fill that position, talk to me, and we'll see if that can happen. But one of the things that we do during this time, usually the first Sunday of the year, is we have an installation liturgy that we can read, and a prayer. So let's start this new year right and share this together. Dear friends, you have been called by God and chosen by the people of God for leadership in the church. This ministry is a blessing and a serious responsibility. It recognizes your special gifts and calls you to work among us and for us. In love, we thank you for accepting your obligation and challenge you to offer your best to the Lord, to this people, and to our ministry to the world. Live a life in Christ and make him known in your witness and your work. So as you look at this list, if you are on this list or if you have a leadership role in the church, join with me. Do you this day, folks, acknowledge yourself a disciple of Jesus Christ? If so, answer, I do. Will you devote yourself to the service of God in the world? If so, answer, I will. Will you so live that you enable this church to be a people of love and peace? If so, answer, I will. Will you do all in your power to be responsible to the task for which you have been chosen? If so, answer, I will. By the United Methodist Church, men, United Methodist women, and United Methodist youth, let us all pray. Almighty God, pour out your blessing upon these your servants who have been given particular ministries in your church. Grant them grace to give themselves wholeheartedly in your service. Keep before them the example of our Lord, who did not think of himself first, but gave himself us for us all. Let them share his ministry and consecration, that they may enter his joy. Guide them in their work. Reward their faithfulness with the knowledge that through them your purposes are accomplished. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, and all the people said, Amen. Dear friends, rejoice that God provides laborers for the vineyard. Will you do all that you can to assist and encourage them in the responsibilities to which they have been called, giving them your cooperation, your counsel, and your prayers? And then the congregation says, I will. I will. Amen. Well, let's stand together. It is so great to have those folks working in the church, but let's stand together now as we receive the gospel message. We are looking at the Gospel of Matthew this morning, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And it reads like this. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born the King of the Jews? For we observed his star at his rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the people and the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. And they told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may go and pay him homage.' When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So, have you ever been in this situation that someone gives you a gift and you don't have a gift to give back to them? Have you ever been in that situation? Or you give something to somebody and they don't necessarily have something to reciprocate, and it makes you feel a little bit awkward. And it is awkward. And you feel embarrassed sometimes. Or did you ever get a gift and think, "What were they thinking? I could never use this, not in a million years." And then you pretend that you like it. And sometimes it is hard. I know my brother is not very good at it. If you give him something that he doesn't like or already has, without a shadow of doubt, you know that it is a dud because it is written all over his face. Now, gift-giving is certainly a challenge, is it not? And there's always the safe gift of money or a gift card, and that is great in some cases. Thank you, church, for the gift card that you gave me. But when the gift is really personal, it means so much, such as the quilt that I received for pastor appreciation. I knew it was specific, especially for me. It is cool to give a gift when you know the people have heard, or it is especially for you. And when that doesn't work, I guess gift cards sometimes are a good thing. But why talk about gifts? Christmas is much more than that, isn't it? In fact, Christmas is almost over with. And some of us have returned some of those gifts already and have store credit. Well, the church calendar states that this is Epiphany Sunday. It's the Epiphany of the Lord. This is Epiphany Sunday. It is the closing for the church of the Christmas season already. Next Sunday, all the decorations will be down. The pulpit will probably be back up where it usually is. Back to normal. But Epiphany, say that with me this morning, Epiphany. Just the word Epiphany. And we should be saying it like it's something exciting. Like if you read comic books, Captain Marvel yells out, Shazam! And think about Emeril. What does he say? He says, Bam, if you remember him from the cooking show. Or the people in California during the gold rush, they said, Eureka! So say it with me this morning with feeling. Epiphany! Say it, Epiphany! It is the Sunday where we celebrate the Magi coming to give the gifts to the newborn king. Our working definition this morning for Epiphany is going to be a sudden, surprising happening that changes everything completely. And these wise men had such an experience. They had a what? They had an epiphany. Now, these wise men, were thought by many scholars to be astrologers. And another name that we use to call them is magi, which can also mean magician. But they were thought by many a scholar to be astrologers. They followed the stars. They were not Jews. They were thought to be Gentiles. Astrologers of this type were not talked about very highly throughout Scripture. In fact, they were thought not to be of God, maybe somewhat evil. Yet they bring the Christ child gifts, and they are received. We can see through this, then, that Jesus came for all people. Okay, stay with me this morning. There are some things about these wise men that we think about that must have come from tradition because they don't necessarily come from Scripture. First, the wise men, these astrologers, were not at the manger scene when Jesus was born, like we have them in our nativity. Yet scholars believe that it was probably close to 2 years when they found Jesus the Christ. That is why Herod wanted to kill all the babies up to 2 years old and younger. We find that in the book of Matthew. Another thing to be aware of is that it never said that there were three kings or three magi. We know that they weren't kings. There may have been three kings or three magi or three wise men, but Scripture does not record that. But you may be saying that you know that there were three kings because they had names, didn't they? They had names called Melchior, Caspar, and Belshazzar. Now, this totally came out of legend or tradition and not out of Scripture. The reason we say that there were three kings is because there were three gifts. Three gifts, and they were gold, frankincense, and myrrh. One piece of information I read was these wise men, these magi, these astrologers, usually traveled in groups of 12. But that is just one approach. And these gifts were usually brought to, these kind of gifts were usually brought to those of royalty. Gold associated with the monarchy, fit for a king, fragrant substances such as frankincense and myrrh were a royal treat. So these are gifts for a king. The scripture also tells us that these magi, these astrologers, were following a star, which would make sense if they were astrologers. And when it stopped, they were overwhelmed with great joy. Like the shepherds on the night Christ was born, they had an epiphany. These people knew that the world was to be changed, and it would not be the same. And they responded with gifts that they felt were appropriate to royalty. The Christ child presented himself, and the men did not go to him empty-handed. So, the question this morning, as we look at Epiphany in 2016, how do we, as a church, approach Christ child? Is it awkward, like the experience that we don't have a gift to match? Do we approach the Christ child with epiphany or an epiphanic? I don't know if that's necessarily a word, but an epiphanic attitude. The Magi knew that the kingdom was at hand. Do we? We are a church that responds incredibly well with a financial need. When there is a financial need, we will respond very well. But how do we respond to the least, the lost, and those that are hungry for God? Is the kingdom something that we keep within these walls, which is easy to do, or is the kingdom something that we take outside of these walls? Approach the outside with our gifts and our response. That is what we are called to do. Got something to tell you, folks. We just got done celebrating Christmas. Let me tell you that Lent is a little more than a month away. Can you believe that? Easter will be here soon. And if you do not believe me, you can already get your Reese's eggs over at Sheetz. I had one already. I haven't even eaten my Reese's trees, and the Reese's eggs are here. But how do we approach Christ like the wise men and his kingdom? God's kingdom is something to ponder. And as we think about it, I can think of no better way to think about how we approach Christ, the Christ child and the kingdom, than to start by remembering the sacred meal of the Holy Communion is a remembering type of event. So as we go to the table, as we celebrate Christ this morning, let us ponder what gift we have to offer as we seek to offer our hearts to the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Lord God, as we celebrate in your holy meal today, as we remember this epiphany of the Lord's Sunday, help it to be an epiphany for us that we need to live for you and celebrate this gift that does not fade, that does not go away, that will be with us and help us through the rest of our lives, the gift of Christ. Help us to know how we are to use our gifts to share that to our world and to receive it. And we pray this in your name. Amen. Let's join together with the response to the Word of God this morning with the Apostles' Creed. Stand if you're so able. Share with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let's join together with the hymn of praise, Angels from the Realms of Glory. To the Lord in prayer today, let me draw your attention to the flip side of our scripture passage this morning. Has those folks that we remember in prayer throughout our week and the days to come. Take this home and pray for these folks. But let me add some things onto this. We have some joys and concerns to add on to this. We want to invite you to stay and have some cake with us as we celebrate the coming of a wedding this week of Jason and Stephanie. So we have some cake to celebrate that this morning. So we want to celebrate that this week. We also have been celebrating some lives, and we want to lift up that as a joy and also a concern, celebrating the life of William Mays this week. So we want to be lifting up that family in concern as we celebrate that life. And also tomorrow, we will be celebrating the life of Shirley Bell, who passed away this week as well. So we can be praying for those families and also be celebrating the fact that they are in much better places. Also, we have a celebration to Don Bittner talked about somebody who is hitting a milestone today. We want to celebrate Doug Ostergaard, who turns 80 today. And so let's sing a happy birthday to him. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Doug, happy birthday to you. We celebrate with you today, brother, so that's a milestone. Any other things to be added onto our prayer concerns or joys today? Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity to gather on this Epiphany Sunday. Help us to be excited about who you are. Help us to celebrate that in our lives. And Lord, as we come before you, we have these prayer concerns that we want to lift up, these things that are on our hearts. And we want to lift up those families that are dealing with loss. We pray for Shirley's family, for the Mays family, and we lift them up to you. We pray for others who are experiencing loss today that maybe we do not know about, but we lift them up to you. We pray for those in our community that are struggling with their health and with finances and with their emotional state and spiritual struggles. We lift them up to you. We want to continue to pray for those who can't get here on Sunday morning because of health problems. Continue to pray for Betty Brooks and for Peg Carey, for Marlene Richards, for Barb Weigel, for Chuck McMurdy, and for others, Lord. We thank you for such a wonderful Christmas celebration that we've been able to have so far at this church. And we pray as we move beyond and move towards Lent, Lord, that we would be people who would walk as signposts for your kingdom. Show us those areas in our community that we can reach out to. And we thank you ahead of time for those opportunities. And Lord, we pray for our own selves today and lift ourselves up to you. Lord, if we are struggling, I just pray that you would touch us where we need to be touched. Heal us where we need to be healed. And move us to where we need to go. And we pray all these things in your most blessed name. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. As we prepare our hearts this morning, one thing I am joyful for and grateful for that I did not say is just the leadership and the people who are involved in the church. Sometimes we are people that continue to do the same things year after year after year. I know Priscilla and Di have done Christian education for a long time. Shar has done membership care for how many years?
13.
How many?
13.
That's a long time. I thought that you said 30, but you're heading towards 30, right? So, but we're grateful for those folks who step up and do those kind of things in our church. So I am very grateful for those people, and those people are joys to me, as you all are, but I appreciate those folks who give of their time. But let's share today and prepare our hearts for this holy and sacred meal. Join with me. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him and who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Join with me. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of need. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. Let's greet each other this morning with the love of Christ. Let's prepare our hearts this morning for the morning offering. Father, as we present this gift that we received to your church, we pray that we would be the kind of people that would share this gift with our community in ways that would show Christ to them. And we just pray this in your most blessed name. Amen. You may be seated. Let's share together with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good thing and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed us into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, he fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over with, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us all pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And deliver us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Amen. The United Methodist Church practices what we call an open table. Therefore, you do not need to be a member of this church or any church to receive communion today. All we ask is that you know Christ as your Lord. We also have gluten-free bread up here, and if you need that, just let one of the ushers know. But let's prepare our hearts this morning for this holy and sacred meal. We'll be taking it in our pews. You'll first receive the bread. You can hold on to it until we all get the bread, and then we'll take it together, and likewise with the cup. So let's prepare our hearts this morning to remember who Jesus is and what he came to do. Himself up for you. He took the bread, he broke it, and said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of Christ." Take and eat in remembrance of Christ. Thank you.
Ninth.
Jesus took the cup, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink. This is my blood poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Take and drink in remembrance of Christ." Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity to share and remember who you are and what you came to do. And as we go our separate ways today, help us to take that memory and live it out. And we just pray this in your name. Amen. Let's join together with our closing hymn, "Go Tell It on the Mountain," number 251. Stay for some cake after our service and fellowship with one another in honor of Jason and Stephanie's wedding. But let's go forth this morning with the grace of Christ, the love of God, with the communion of the Holy Spirit. Let it be with you all. Amen.